controversial. He's committed. And he's conservative. It's the Tony McGhee Show on 106.7 My Talker Radio.
Welcome to the Tony McGhee Show on the new 106.7 FM My Talker Radio. Give us a call at 910-833-8764. Our website is www.wmit1067fm. And, of course, we are streaming live video. So when you get to our website, click on our yellow talk media icon. Have us right there on any computer. Also, if you need our live audio, I tell you what you do. Just click on our red Listen Live button and you'll have us right there. Also, you can download our apps for Apple or Android. Put us right there on any mobile device. Follow us on Twitter. Like us on Facebook. Just search for WMIT 1067 FM. I'm your host, Tony McGhee. And you know what? Do something a little bit different today because I tell you what, we were pressed for time, and we were hustling, doing all, and running through the traffic. But, you know, we have with us here Pastor Chuck Baldwin. And, you know, one of the things that, you know, I want you to know about this man, this is an awesome man. He has been a candidate for the presidency of the United States, representing the Constitutional Party. And I just think that's an awesome thing. Welcome to the Tony McGhee Show, Pastor. And it's just been a great time having you here in our city this week.
Great to be with you, Tony. Thank you very much.
Yeah, and you know, one of the things that, you know, Pastor Baldwin is talking about, you know, there's a couple of things that are going on, you know, in the church right now that causes us, contributes to us not being as effective as we should be. You know, the 501c3, it's kind of like a, I guess that's like having something tied around your neck and thrown in the sea because it's bogging the church down. Church is not as effective as we should be. And also the idea that we have this subservient concept and idea of what it is to submit. So we take Romans 13, we're taking that completely out of context. And so he's here in Wilmington. Of course, he's at Wilmington Christian Center. This is the last night, the last meeting tonight at 2817 B North 23rd Street. Get right there if you can be there. It's going to be great. You get a chance to meet him and talk to him and listen to him. But, you know, one of the things that I think is so important is that when we understand what's holding us up, now we can find out what the solution is. Because all of us are asking the question, well, why is it that the church is not effective? I mean, you know, in one of your editorials, you know, you had that referencing George Barner's editorial. I mean, right. 90% of the preachers say, yep, the Bible talks about these, but less than 10% of those questions said that they would even preach these principles. We exactly. are in trouble.
Oh, we're very much in trouble. I don't think anybody doubts that we're in trouble. I think even many in the church know we're in trouble. The problem is they don't seem to realize what the solution is. They keep looking for the solution in politics. Republican Party will do this. Democrat Party will do this. We need this president. We need this president. We need to elect these people to Congress. Everybody's focused on politics. It's never been politics that has taken America into the great stratosphere of blessing and success. It's always been the church, and the church is led by the pulpits. In colonial America, it was the Black Regiment pulpits of New England that brought America into our war for independence, our Declaration, our Constitution, Bill of Rights. Everything that we enjoy as a free people today came as a result of those patriot pulpits in the mid-1700s teaching their people the truth of liberty from God's word. As a result, they were prepared. They were able, willing, and ready to implement those principles when the time came. Without that leadership of the church and the pastor of the church, we are struggling to keep our head above water. And until the Christian community especially stops expecting the media, whether it's Fox News or whether it's Rush Limbaugh or whatever the talking head might be, or the network might be, or the political party might be, and start recognizing that it's the responsibility of the church and the pastor in particular to be the rudder and the compass of society, we're not going to get a handle on this. And all we're going to do is continue to deteriorate culturally, spiritually, and every other way.
I can see your point. And just to kind of sum what I think I hear you saying, we're not really in a political battle. We're not really in a cultural battle. We're in a spiritual battle.
It's a spiritual battle.
And if we don't deal with that spiritual root, it's of course it's going to rot the culture. Of course it's going to rot the political, the body politic of a nation. Right. And until we begin to deal with this from a perspective of America has to be intrinsically good. as the French writer said. Well, we had a break, and I tell you what, when we get right back, we're going to continue this conversation with Pastor Chuck Baldwin. You know, we're just on a roll here, just excited. I want you to just come on out and check us out, 2817B North 23rd Street. I'm Tony McGhee on the new 106.7 FM My Talk Radio. Be right back after the break. My Talk Radio. Give us a call again, 910-833-8764. Our website is www.wmit1067fm.com. I'm your host, Tony McGhee. The Tony McGhee Show is brought to you by Coastal Document Systems. For over 20 years, Coastal Document Systems has been your locally owned document solutions specialist. Call them today for personal service and the best quality business machines available. The number is 910-395-9990. That's 910-395-9990. Now, and by the way, just to remind you, we have here in studio with us Pastor Chuck Baldwin. And, you know, as I listen to him, and of course, I've been reading some of his writings and at least one of his books I've read. And I find him to be such a fascinating person. And now to get to know him and talk to him is even more fascinating. I'd forgotten about the idea that and the fact that he actually was a candidate for the presidency of the United States. I tell you what. We might have avoided a whole lot of the problems that we've gone through as a nation if you were president right now. And, you know, one of the things I think is important is I remember years ago, when Reverend Jerry Falwell came on the air and he had, you know, Bringing America Back. And people screamed a bloody murder because, you know, separation of church and state. Really, they kind of want to merge them. And then it's not so much separation. They want submission of the church to the state is what they really want. And but they didn't seem to have a problem with Jesse Jackson going into churches and raising money to finance his campaign. And I found the hypocrisy of that. Some might say, well, that's a black or white, but it really wasn't a racial thing. It's a philosophical position. If you're liberal enough, left-leaning enough, then okay, whatever you do is going to be okay. But if you tend to head toward conservatism, Christian conservatism is what I like to look at right now, then of course that becomes a problem, and you need to keep that separate. And I think this is what Christians need to understand, that we have a duty, a responsibility before God to be involved. You know, if Jesus is our King, we must be there.
Well, every gift that God gives to mankind, it has with it an intrinsic responsibility and a duty. Mm-hmm. Everything that God has given to us, if we have health, then we have a duty to use our health in a way that benefits mankind. If we have a mind, we have a duty to use our mind. Similarly, everything that God gives us has a duty associated with it. Freedom, liberty, it's a gift of God. It is not something that we get from government. You know, Thomas Jefferson wrote in the Declaration that these blessings were endowed to us by our Creator, and that He's given us life, liberty, pursuit of happiness, etc. That they're not the bestowment of government. They are the gift of God. Well, if liberty and freedom is a gift of God, then we have a duty and a responsibility associated with it. And I think what we see going on in America today is because, and we can talk a little bit about why this is, and I think that's very important as it relates to the church. But the bottom line is we're not stepping up to the plate when it comes to exercising our duty and our responsibility. It's almost like somehow or another we were bequeathed freedom and liberty because of the sacrifice of others, and we were. But if we are not willing to pay a price and exercise a duty in order to bequeath liberty to our posterity, there isn't going to be any liberty for our posterity. It's not about us. It's about our children and our grandchildren. you know, each generation must maintain and pass on liberty for itself. It cannot rely upon the sacrifice of those that have gone before us. We must continue the sacrifice. And so therefore we have an obligation as Christians, just like anybody else. Anybody who lives in a free society, you don't have to be a Christian to get this, but especially for Christians who talk about the freedom that they have in Christ, they talk about that a lot. You and I talk about that.
Right.
The liberty that we have through the gospel. Okay, so what are we doing with it? What are we doing with the liberty and the freedom that God has bestowed upon us? Not government, God. We have a duty in order to maintain and to bring that into the next generation. That's not being done. We are squandering the freedoms and the liberties that we were bequeathed by our ancestors. And the result is freedom and liberty in our country is crumbling before our very eyes. And what's the church doing? Particularly, you ask about the church. The church, for the most part, is it's recreational evangelism. It's entertainment evangelism. You know, it's feel-good-ism. It's don't-offend-anybody-ism. You know, it's how big can our congregation be? How big can our buildings be? How big are our offerings? You know, it's all about these physical, material manifestations of quote-unquote success. And so what's happening is in trying to satisfy these man-made carnal goals of success that we've adopted into the church, we're neglecting the principles of Scripture as it relates to the maintenance of liberty. Everything that our founding fathers fought and died for is founded and grounded in revealed law, the Word of God, and in natural law, in the conscience of man. And if pastors are not willing to express and articulate those values and principles, teach them, explain them, extrapolate them to the Christian community, it's going to be lost. And that's what happens. It's lost. And we can't get past, you know, well, it's a Republican issue or a Democrat or it's a conservative or it's a liberal. We can't get past that. And you talk to the average Christian and his understanding of freedom is no different than anybody that you would find in your local pub or bar. It's we have reduced freedom to a political solution. Boy, that's the last place you want to entrust the future of liberty is to the politician. It's not a political party that's going to bring America to greatness and to freedom and liberty. It's not a politician. It is the principles of freedom that God has given to us, again, through natural law in our conscience and through revealed law, the Word of God. Until pastors begin to explain and preach and stand for those principles and teach them to their people, Tony, it's not going to happen.
Well, I guess, and I believe you, and I agree with you. I think what we're calling for and what I want to be calling for, and I think, you know, this circumstance and situation and the times in which we live are calling for it. For the most part, not just the memberships, but pastors are going to have to repent. We're going to have to repent for having dropped the ball. And sometimes we've dropped the ball, not in the sense that we were in some type of intentional neglect. We took our eye off the ball. We didn't understand what the purpose, we forgot or we were mistaught what the purpose of the church is. And that, number one, is to raise up disciples, one that disciplines himself. That requires sacrifice. If we're going to defend freedom, we're going to have to be disciplined and we're going to have to make some sacrifices. And if we don't do that, we're going to find ourselves possibly in this generation losing our freedom. We'll be right back after the break. I'm Tony McGhee on the new 106.7 FM, My Talk Radio. Do not touch that dial. We'll be right back.
Welcome back to the Tony McGhee Show, live from the studios of 106.7 My Talker Radio. The phone lines are open now, so give Dr. Tony McGhee a call, 910-833-8764. That's 910-833-8764.
Welcome back to the Tony McGhee Show on the new 106.7 FM, My Talk Radio. Give us a call at 910-833-8764. Our website is www.wmyt1067fm.com. I tell you what, there's so much going on And you know, when we look at these different things that are going on, and really when we start talking about the ineffectiveness, and you know, I'm not picking on any church or picking on any pastors, but the ineffectiveness of the church, the established church right now is evident everywhere we look. What am I talking about? We're talking about crime is going up. We're talking about horrendous problems with immorality. I mean, okay, the Bible tells us that no man is perfect. We've got that figured out. None of us are perfect. But there seems to be an unwillingness to preach in a way that's going to challenge believers to grow into what God has called us to grow into, to be those disciples, those that would discipline themselves. And, you know, and I think that plays right into what we were talking about earlier, you know, with pastors. I think we just need, all of us, including me, we just need to repent so that we can get about doing the business that Jesus has put us here. And that is, yes, winning people to Jesus. But beyond that, that's the step one, making disciples. We need to repent that we're just making sure we don't hurt people's feelings, making sure they don't take the tithe away, making sure that they show up and make sure that, you know, I mean, it's something that we were talking about this week in these series of meetings, that in many of our churches, the members have become assets. And so we need to repent of that. I mean, that's horrendous.
Well, what you said right before the break, that maybe the pastors are unintentionally avoiding these issues, not addressing the controversies and so forth, things that are so pertinent to our nation today. But there's an interesting research that was just recently done by the George Barna Group, which is the preeminent researcher of modern Christianity in the country and has been for many decades. And he basically wanted to know what was the attitude of the pastors relative to their involvement with society and political issues, et cetera. And of course, what he found out through his research is that the church by and large is totally uninvolved in any of that. So then he got to asking a little bit more about, you know, what was the pastor thinking? What's the philosophy, et cetera? And here's what he came up with. And this is the one part of the survey that I was actually a little bit surprised about, Tony. I mean, the rest of it, I pretty much anticipated. And he only confirmed what I already knew. But the thing that I was a little surprised about was when he asked the question regarding the pastor's understanding of the biblical application of political issues. And what he found out is that 90% of the pastors in America that were surveyed, and I believe it's pretty accurate across the board, his survey is pretty scientific, said that yes, the Bible did and does relate to our salient political issues of the day. That's the part that surprised me, because usually what you'll hear a pastor say is, well, you know, God's just called me to preach the gospel, and that's politics, and I'm not supposed to get involved in that. But no, the research said that 90% of America's pastors across the board admit that the Bible does speak to the salient political issues of the day. Of course, which it does. But they admitted that. But then they also admitted that only 10% of the pastors said that they would publicly address those issues from the pulpit. Now, that's not an unwillingness. That's not an ignorance. You know, that's not...
That's purposeful.
That is purposeful. It is deliberate. So we're not dealing with ignorant pastors. We're dealing with deliberately disobedient pastors.
So repentance is the order of the day.
It really is the order of the day. And here's the thing, though, that goes along with what you were just saying also. And they said the reason that they wouldn't do it is because it would hinder the success of their church. Success, that's the word. So then he probed a little bit deeper, and he said, okay, how do you define success? And here's what they said. Success was big crowds, big offerings, the square footage of the buildings, how many programs the church has, and how many staff members the church has. That's the five-fold criteria of success that churches and pastors have today. Now, where do you find that in the New Testament, Tony? Where do you find anywhere where the Apostle Paul talks about his ministry, his work, his life, that he talks anywhere about how many people were in the church? How big were the offerings? How many square footage were the building? They didn't even own buildings in the book of Acts. How many staff members did we have? You know, how many programs do we have? Children's programs, youth programs, elderly programs. I mean, you know, it's everything about the church now is it's not really a church. It's a corporation. And that goes back to the 501c3 issue that you started talking about at the onset of the program.
Right.
The churches are not churches. They're corporations. When they became a corporation whenever their church enlisted in the 501c3 tax-exempt status of the IRS. And under the IRC, that's the Internal Revenue Code, they're recognized not as being a church. They're recognized as being a corporation. It doesn't matter whether, you know, the NFL, the National Football League is a 501c3 tax-exempt organization. Yeah. Well, the church is no different in the eyes of the law, in the eyes of the IRS. The church is no different than the National Football League. It's just a nonprofit institution, organization. So they accepted that from the state in order to receive this magical tax-exempt, you know, status that they get on purchases and on giving from the contributors. And as a result, now the pastor is a CEO. He's not a pastor. He's a chief executive officer, or maybe a CFO, chief financial officer. His job is to keep the money coming in. His job is to keep the crowds coming in, because if he keeps the crowds coming in, the money's going to come in. It's all about money. It's all about the generating of the corporate status, the image of the corporation. And so we've lost the heart and the soul of what a church really is all about. A church is not a corporation. You know, a pastor is not a CEO. You know, he's supposed to be a man of God, a prophet of God, a watchman on the wall. He's supposed to be the teacher and the instructor of the flock. But now it's all about money. And another issue that I think that we should touch on here as we're talking about this is the debt issue. How many of our churches are head over heels, Tony, in debt? And you know what the Bible says, that the borrower is servant to the lender.
That's right.
And so you have a servitude that the church has voluntarily accepted through the accumulation of excessive debt. You know, I could tell you that I know of, I don't know how many churches, that literally every month they only pay the interest on the debt. They can't even pay the principal of the debt. They're just barely being able to pay the interest on the debt. I mean, so they're going further and further behind financially every month. They're not even keeping up. They're not even staying on the level playing field. You know, and so you start thinking, and then add to that, okay, salary. You add to that, you know, overhead. You add to that utilities. You add to that insurance and retirement and health benefits. And you start adding up all of the other costs associated with operating this corporation. And you recognize that the churches and pastors say, wait a minute, if I say something controversial about this political issue or that political issue, I may lose 2% of my congregation. I may lose 5% of my congregation. If I lose 5% of my income, how am I going to pay the staff? How am I going to pay the bills? Everything, the bottom line of everything in the church today, for the most part, is money. It's money. I hate to say that, but it's money, plain and simple. The fruit of the gospel, the purpose of the gospel, everything that the church was created for has been totally, for the most part, forgotten in so many of our churches, and it's become a business. I mean, where in the New Testament, where in the early church history do you find where churches even owned a building? They didn't even own a building. You cannot even find church ownership of property anywhere in the New Testament. It was a mobile church. They went from place to place. Persecution drove them. Evangelism drove them. Missionary work drove them. But they were a very mobile, free church, many times meeting in private locations and in other groups and not even coming together except occasionally in a larger assemblage. The model of the early church that we find in the book of Acts and then which continued in early church history has been totally abandoned. And now it's all about success-driven ministry. You read the books, the periodicals, the newsletters, everything in the church world today is about success-driven ministry.
How do you build it bigger? How do you get more crowds? How do you do all of that kind of thing? You know, one of the things that I think is so tragic when we look at this and we see the death spiral of this nation, then you can tie that directly to the failure of the church. Because of all of our preaching and all of our services is what we normally call them, but I guess that's to service the debt, and we were a corporation, so now we're providing a service and all that. Right. But if everything is about how do I service a debt, then I'm not even preaching from the right motive. I'm
exactly.
preaching from the perspective of to make sure the offerings are good instead of I need to create disciples. Call the hearts of men to repentance. That's something. Well, anyway, I'm Tony McGhee on the new 106.7 FM My Talk Radio. We'll be right back after the break. Radio. Give us a call, 910-833-8764. Our website is www.wmit1067fm.com. I'm your host, Tony McGhee. And of course, we have in studio with us, we have who's become such a fast friend, Pastor Chuck Baldwin. Just really appreciate you being here on the Tony McGhee Show. Just want to let everybody know you can contact Pastor Chuck Baldwin at www.chuckbaldwinlive.com. I think I got that right.
Got it.
And also, you know, just to let you know why he's here, of course, as you can see, he's a wealth of information, what I call reasonable information. It's very reasoned. You know, I'm sick and tired of, let me just take a little side journey. I'm sick and tired of Christians relying on emotionalism mm-hmm. instead of presenting things in a factual, logical, reasonable way so that we can understand it and make reasonable decisions. I mean, if somebody accepts Christ because you pump them up high emotionally and then they get saved and they think that that's what Christianity is about, they're probably not going to stick in there because it's not about emotion. Sometimes you don't feel like doing the right thing. Sometimes you don't feel like making good decisions, but it's about living a principled life. And again, let me just jump out of that for right quick. But Pastor Chuck Baldwin is here. But was here last night and all day today, three meetings today. Encourage you to get over here at Wilmington Christian Center at 2817 B North 23rd Street, rather, right here in Wilmington. And one of the things he's talking about, the church project, the Liberty Church Project, is a way of encouraging churches to really pay attention to the laws of nature, you know, those biblical natural laws that the Bible talks about and the founders talked about, the laws of nature and of nature's God. Those are important principles. Also talking about the 501c3 corporation, what that means, why that's a hindrance to the church. And one fascinating aspect of information that he's been talking to us about is the misinterpretation of Romans 13. Many times from our pulpits, we present Romans 13 as an unconditional surrender to the federal government. And he said, no, it's jurisdictional. You don't just submit to somebody because they have a position. You submit because, yes, they have the position, but they're doing the right thing because you don't submit to evil as a Christian. And so, again, that's that website is www.chuckbaldwinlive.com. And just go right there and check that out. You can probably, I'm sure you can email him and actually check out everything that's going on in that ministry. He is truly doing the Lord's work. And matter of fact, while you're there, you might be able to check out some things about the Liberty Church Project and help out in any way that you can. And so, again, you know, Pastor Baldwin, just want to let you know we really appreciate you being here in Wilmington at our church and, of course, on our show and just in the city of Wilmington. I think you're making a great, I would call it, grace deposit here in Wilmington, and I believe that fruit is going to come forth from that.
Thank you, Tony. I believe that, and I believe that God is going to be using you in a great way in this area in the days to come. Yeah, the Liberty Church Project was a result of hundreds and hundreds of people around the country asking me what they could do. They've been going to churches all over their communities, trying to find a pastor that would stand up and speak, and one that would not be afraid to address the controversial issues. And what's the cause? We got into the 501c3 issue. We got into the Romans 13 issue. So the question was, well, what can we do? And as a result of that, after this is a couple year period of time praying about it, I God led me to start the Liberty Church Project. I asked my supporters around the country if they felt impressed of God to support the Liberty Church Project financially. I left it there. I left it in the hands of God, in the hands of the people that had been supporting me. Well, in just a very quick period of time, the people responded to the need financially, and the Liberty Church Project was launched. This is actually our second visit to a local community, to a local pastor and a local church, introducing the Liberty Church Project to that community. The first one was in just outside Dallas, Texas, 2 weeks ago, and now here in Wilmington, North Carolina, with you, Pastor Tony McGhee. So thank you for your invitation to come. And basically what we're trying to get people to realize is the importance of the Patriot pulpit. The thing that we don't have today in America that we had in early America was the Patriot pulpit, the Black Regiment, as it was called by the British Crown. Those colonial pastors who stood up in their pulpits every Sunday and articulated the principles of liberty to their people, to the point that when April 19, 1775 rolled around and it came time for those Minutemen to stand on Lexington Green in defiance of tyranny, it was a congregation of church men from the Church of Lexington, pastored by Jonas Clark, that stood on Lexington Green that fateful morning. The shot was fired, heard around the world. Our war for independence began, eventually leading to the Declaration of Independence and everything that we now know as the United States of America. Never would have happened without the Patriot pulpit. That's what's missing today. And so what we're doing is we're trying to focus on the Patriot pulpit. We're trying to focus on the importance of breaking out of the matrix, so to speak,
right.
with the 501c3 incorporation status, and trying to get people to understand, again, the principles of biblical natural law, and so that their pastors can be the watchman on the wall again in order to bring our society back into conformity with the principles that God has established in His Word. And so, like, for our first night, last night at your church, we talked about the Patriot pulpit, colonial American pulpit and churches. Then we talked about Romans chapter 13 this morning. We dealt with that at length this afternoon. Barbara Cate, who's a legal analyst, who's worked for the Biblical Law Center for so many years, talked about the 501c3 trap. And now tonight in your service, we're going to talk about the natural law principles of the Bible. And by the time we're done, hopefully we'll be able to have brought to your congregation and to the other pastors that have come as well to the meetings with the inspiration as well as the information that you folks right here in Wilmington can be that beacon of liberty here for this part of North Carolina. And, you know, over the next few years, Tony, I'm praying and hopeful that as we do this from place to place, we're talking about South Carolina trip coming up. We're talking about Indiana. We're talking about South Florida. We're talking about Texas again. We're talking about Idaho. You know, we're talking about places already that we're going to be going and introducing these principles to. Pastors are hungering. There are people that are hungering for these principles. Who knows? The answer is not going to come in Washington. It's not going to come in the political parties.
That's right.
It's going to come from the pulpit and from the churches. Who knows what God's going to do, Tony? You're a part of it.
Well, that's great. And I think it's so fascinating because, you know, studying this and I quote a lot of your editorials anyway in your opinion pieces and so forth. And so when there was an opportunity to make this invitation and have you come, I said, well, I'm going to ask them to come. I don't know what they're going to say,
yeah.
but you know, here you are. And this has just been so great. And I want to encourage you we're running out of time for this broadcast session tonight, but I want to encourage you. Drop whatever you're doing. Head on over to Wilmington Christian Center, 2817B North 23rd Street, right here in Wilmington. And, of course, Pastor Chuck Baldwin is going to be talking about those natural law, biblical natural law principles. And, you know, you've heard me talk about these things on this show. And I tell you what, he's certainly qualified to even go more so in depth about the importance. Listen, without these principles, there is no America as we've known it. There is no abolition abolition of slavery. None of these things can happen, because one of the things that the abolitionists did is they held on to those basic principles and said, wait a minute, you cannot have this this monstrosity in a free republic that's based on the principles of natural law, as the Bible teaches. And it's amazing to me that we forget the history of that, right? How so many things were changed and challenged because pastors stood in their pulpit Sunday after Sunday, week after week, year after year, whether it was popular or not, and said, this is the truth, this is the word of God, and, you know, let the chips fall where they may. Right. They weren't worried about, and I guess it's, they weren't worried about whether or not they were going to make some extreme payment on something either.
And they weren't worried about the IRS and 501c3.
That's exactly
either.
Right.
And it starts 7 o'clock, is that right?
We start at 7 o'clock.
7 o'clock tonight.
We start at 7 o'clock, and I didn't say that. Thank you for saying that for me. I didn't say that, but yeah, we get started at 7 o'clock. Be there. It's going to be pretty awesome. Now, we're going to beat feet right from here, so we'll be there in just a few minutes, but you can be there even before we get there. So I just want to encourage you to do that. And again, thank you so much for being here on the Tony McGhee Show.
Thank you very much, Tony. Glad to be here.
Okay.
God bless you.
All right. Well, I tell you what, thank you so much for listening. Have a great evening. We'll be talking to you tomorrow. Again, I'm Tony McGhee on the new 106.7 FM, My Talk Radio. Have a great evening.